Well, good evening, everybody. Would like to take this opportunity and welcome you to our Hendersonville Regional Planning Commission meeting for Tuesday, March 7th, 2017. It appears that we have a quorum in place. Would like to make a note that Mr. Bristol is absent, Mr. Pinson, as well as Chairman Freudenthal. And our planning director is on vacation. So everybody is here that needs to be here, and we can proceed. First item on the agenda tonight is a public hearing for the Davidson Academy to rezone 76.19 acres from suburban residential low density SR1 to multifamily residential plan development MFRPD, and to approve a preliminary master development plan for Davidson Academy and 172 townhomes. The property is located on the south side of Stop 30 Road, west of Drakes Creek Road, as shown on Sumner County Property Tax Map 145, parcels 54.00 and 54.01. As many of you probably know, the applicant has pulled their submittal for this evening, and so as far as actual voting tonight for this rezone, that will not occur. However, we do have a public hearing scheduled, and since we're here and we're all dressed up, we might as well go ahead and have our public hearing. And then, of course, the applicant will probably be reassigning their submittal on another agenda, and we will try to find a way to accommodate all of you citizens that would like to speak on this tonight as well as at another point, and we'll try to handle that at the end of this public hearing. So having said that, we do have some people that have signed up, and once again, if we want to hear all comments that you have, we welcome all comments, and we would like to just kind of let you know that we would like to keep within the 3-minute mark to give everybody a chance, and that'll help us. And with that said, we're going to go right into the public hearing, and it looks like the first one is Gene, I hope this is right, R. Sorrell. Sorrell? Did I say that right? Or Farrell? Okay. They're not here. Okay. How about Tony Johnson? Is Tony Johnson here? Turn you on here. Okay. Go ahead.
Yes, I live at 1009 West Bank Drive.
If you would introduce yourself for the record.
I'm Tony Johnson. I have lived at that address since 2000. My wife and I and our daughter, who is 17 years old, a new driver of the city of Hendersonville, we live at that residence. I have quite a few notes that I'm probably going to hold and share if there's an additional hearing. But I will share with you what happened to me about 7:20 this morning when I pulled out of Cross Creek Lane onto Stop 30 Road. I go about 200 yards, and a brick delivery truck's coming down the center of the road, had his offloader on the back, and runs me off the road into the ditch. If you haven't traveled Stop 30 Road lately, it is not a safe road. It's being used as a cut-through when Vietnam veterans backs up. It doesn't take many days for you to go out and look, and you can witness that. The community has been promised since the flood of 2010 that the Stop 30 Bridge would be replaced, and I understand that there's funds to do that, but there's no plans to widen the road. If there's no plans to widen the road, the infrastructure cannot support, whether it's 172 or 176 townhomes, as their plan showed last Thursday night. It cannot support that. Davidson Kennedy also shared with us last Thursday they have no plans right now to build on that site. It's mostly to put the townhomes in so they can obtain revenue from it and reinvest it in their existing campus in Davidson County, which does not have any townhomes on it. So I just want to let my voice be heard that I oppose the rezoning request.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Next up is John Helton.
Thank you.
Oh, you're fine. You're okay. Take your time. If you would, just introduce yourself for the record.
Sure. My name is John Hilton. I live at 1018 Rutherford Way, and my property backs up to Stop 30 between Whitley and Margaret. So we, I again, I'm here to oppose what's happening. This school, we were all pretty happy with it when it happened 10 years ago. And but I gotta say, I think the motives have changed on this school. It appears to be a money-making project now that property values are up and they're getting ready to, they want to sell it. Now, where this money's going to go, I don't know. Mr. Johnson just made a good point that it's going back down on Old Hickory Boulevard in Davison County. So, I don't know. Our road is terrible out there. Stop 30 is terrible. Most of y'all, I'm sure you're familiar with Stop 30, of what we've got there, and it's in bad need of repair there. The shoulders in some places, right immediately by the asphalt, or drop-offs like this. I've seen two rollovers myself, and that's just one of many problems. But I think there's a lot of consideration here. We're happy for that school. I'm happy for the school. I speak only for myself, of course. But I think most of us thought that would be an asset to the community. But it appears that the motives have changed on Davison Academy, that they're here to make some money, to help pay for their school, or to take it to Davison County. I can't answer that. That's something they'll have to answer. But that's really about all I have. We'll get into much more details later. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hilton. Next
one
up.
One more thing I might say. As you can see, I have some problems here walking and climbing steps and all that good stuff. And nowhere when I talked with these folks last week was there any handicap accessible provisions there. All steps everywhere. So just wanted to make that point there, that if they put something in out here, there needs to be some handicap accessible situations for seniors and infirmed people such as myself.
Thank you, Mr. Hill.
Thank you.
Next up is David Hobdy. You would just introduce yourself for the record.
Yeah, David Hobdy, 1001 Rutherford Way. I've lived there since 2001. And like the majority of the people here, I'm also opposed to the zoning change. Based on Hendersonville's land and use transportation plan, the area we are discussing is defined as suburban living and is currently zoned SR1, as you guys have stated. SR1 is defined as low density residential and complementary institutional use that should not be detrimental to the residential character of the area. The proposed multifamily residential also states similar verbiage, stating that the multifamily dwellings and institutional use should not be detrimental to the residential character of the area. This past week at the community meeting that Davidson Academy and Meritage Farms held, Meritage Homes stated the proposed townhomes would be similar to the ones on Saundersville Road. That area is designated by the Land Use and Transportation Plan as a regional activity center. The only other high-density residential area in somewhat close proximity to the area we're talking about tonight that is north of Vietnam Veterans are the apartments behind Glenbrook Shopping Center, which is also in an area designated as a regional activity center. The zoning for those two areas are commercially zoned areas. specifically neighborhood commercial. The area being discussed tonight has remained what several would consider the best mix of a suburban and rural lifestyle, and that is what has made this community appealing to most of the homeowners in the area. I actually have a neighbor that just moved in about a year ago or so, and that's part of the reason that he moved in. The area is separated from the current commercially zoned areas by Vietnam Veterans to the south, New Shackle Island to the west, and Drake's Creek Road to the east. The addition of 176 townhomes to the area would be detrimental to the character of the area. I'm speaking specifically to the character of the area. And would significantly be a shift away from the current land use and transportation plan. We are asking the Planning Commission reject the proposed zoning change and that the land in question remain zoned currently as it is, SR1. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hobby. The next up is James, and I hope I get this right. Is it Dungy or?
Yeah, it's Dungy, sir.
Okay.
I kind of just signed that. I wasn't going to speak. I didn't know that I was for speaking, but I will speak.
My name is James. You would just introduce yourself.
Yes, sir. My name is James Dungy. I live at 1005 Kaiser Avenue. That's in Lawson Point subdivision, not too far across the street from the proposal if it gets built. It's kind of odd. I'm a real estate appraiser by trade. I could sit up here and bore you and bore the audience with demographics and things like this and land sales analysis and get into that, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tell you that I came here from Southern California 10 years ago, and what you guys are doing here is trying to destroy the country. That's my opinion. I come from a place that is so developed, it is absolutely sickening to try to go down the road. And I live in a place now, it's sickening to go down to Stop 30. I've only been here 10 years. And it's my opinion that south of the bypass is already destroyed. The developers in this area and the politicians that go along with them cannot say no to more property tax money, no matter what it does to the town. That's my opinion. And I believe that needs to stop. And I believe this townhomes coming in, it's like the development behind the movie theater over there. That's a massive development. I'm a real estate appraiser. I touch this stuff every day. And there are more homes for sale here to buy than you can shake a stick at. We don't, the supply and demand is not off balance. Let's stop destroying this place. And let's make it more sacred. Because when you get it developed like Southern California, you're going to hate it. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you very much.
I oppose it.
Next up is Kenny Furr.
Good evening. My name is Kenny Furr. I'm from 1003 Whispering Wind Way in Hendersonville, right up Drake's Creek Road. I'm very glad that I'm following that gentleman from Southern California. We came here from Long Island, New York, 21 months ago. We're from the future. We've seen this. This has happened there. People flee there now to come to this. They want to be here. I just don't want to see you do what they've done there. And I see it happening, and it scares me. Some of the points I'd like to make to you folks, look at your logo. It's beautiful. It's a bird. It's a sun. It's a boat. In 5 years, is it going to be an apartment building, a bulldozer, and a raging motorist? I mean, this is ridiculous. I don't know what the end game is. I don't know where you're heading. Since we've been here, believe it or not, Durham Farms, I think 1,100 homes. Yeah. That's in my backyard. Ivy Point, I think, is the name of another one. That's now on Anderson Road. That's very close to us. My numbers are right, maybe 75 new homes. Norman Lake, 95 homes. Crutcher Station, 75 to 100 homes. And now, Stop 30. Let's add two more. Let's add two more subdivisions to a road that is aptly named Stop 30, because you have to stop 30 times for fear of going off of it. 1,500 homes, we'll ballpark it. 2 to 3 cars a home. It's about average. 4,000 vehicles within the next 5, 7, 10 years, let's say. 4,000 vehicles. 21 months I've been here. Let me tell you now, the road changes in 21 months. Zero. I say it again. Zero. 4,000 new homes coming. Zero changes in those roads. It's scary. This is a 3-mile radius. I don't know if I can make that clear enough. This is not all of Henderson. This is a 3-mile radius. What is going on in the whole city? You have to apply the brakes, or we will end up like Southern California, like Long Island, New York. Me and my wife left a place, and I kid you not, a quarter of an acre property that we walked out the door at $12,000 a year in property taxes in order to come to what we thought was this wonderful place with very kind people who are wonderful. But what happens when you group a lot of folks in a very small, confined area that is overpopulated? People aren't so kind anymore when they're getting on the roads. People might not be so sweet and, you know, talkative when they're online at the supermarket when they're waiting 30 deep. Things change. I don't think we need a census to tell us that it's 2 pounds of bologna in a 1-pound bag here. Okay, we need to just, all I could say is this, greed is not good. Greed does not work, and it will bite us in the long run. And instead of becoming a cautionary tale on 48 hours, 10 years from now, where we go, what would the death of this wonderful city? Why not be an inspiration to other cities to say, we were able to hold back, we were able to control greed and do the right thing for the people? Thank you. I do oppose this, obviously.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Charles F. Jones.
I'm Charles Jones, and I apologize for my creaky voice. I've got the current congestion. I'm Charles Jones. I live at 122 Crestview Drive in Hendersonville. I'm on the other side of Stop 30. When Davison Academy was proposed, as many other people were, we didn't have any great problem with that. Bill Cheney at Davison Academy assured us that Crestview Drive, which ends right past my house, would have a crash gate, emergency use gate, which I hope, no matter what happens, remains there. But if that area is purchased by the developers, I can't imagine that they would keep that. The other thing is the zoning that they have requested is for the entire 72 acres. Now, many around here are a little bit skeptical of taking and I don't know all the zoning details, but taking the zoning that would fit a high school, K-12 school, would not seem to be housing type. So if we rezone the 72 acres, there's not a whole lot that keeps Davison Academy if they decide not to build, and it's been 10 years since they decided to build, so who knows in the future. But in the event that they did sell the property, then we would have heaven only knows how many units stuck there, because the zoning will be already there to build family housing. One other thing regarding Stop 30, it being narrow, there's sight distance problems on a very large, very steep hill between two of the farms. And as someone said a moment ago, we do have wrecks there as people are run off the road because it won't accommodate construction traffic, large trucks, as well as cars. And so we have wrecks on account of that. The other thing is, if anything proceeds, whether it be housing units a school, a combination of the two. The intersection at Indian Lake Road or Drake's Creek Road, I'm not sure what we call it now, is horrid. It has been funded to be changed for years and years. It has not been changed, and if it's not changed before more of this development takes place, it will be an absolute nightmare to get out of that area. Because while it's being changed, everybody's got to go to New Shackle Island. And that intersection, even after it was, after it has been improved, is also a nightmare. So we would add construction traffic, all of the people coming in and out of those developments, as well as the new residents, if they begin to sell that property, and I should imagine they would. And I hate to be a cynic, but I am. If the developers come in here and develop and do what they need to do, they take their money and go back to Brentwood or wherever their home office is, and they don't have to worry about the effects here. The one other thing that I wanted to mention is the, well, I did mention the site distance. There's one place between the farms where the hill is so steep that on a good day, if there's headlights coming back to you, particularly these horribly bright focused lights, you're blind. Even if you've got good eyes that aren't 71 years old, you're blind. And so that is another problem with Stop 30, that if such a thing goes through, would be that much of a problem. It's difficult to cut down a whole hill, but that would what would have to be done, in my opinion. So to sum up, I'm opposed to the rezoning. I'm particularly opposed to rezoning the entire parcel for residential use. That would seem like unnecessary step if they're going to rezone simply for the planned 172 or 76 units. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. That concludes the number of speakers that we have signed up on the public hearing. As I stated at the beginning of our meeting, we have a situation where the applicant has deferred, so we're not voting on this tonight. However, it's important to us that we hear your comments and that we understand the will of the citizens as well as the developer. And we do know that it's going to come up again at some point as they choose. So I'm hesitant to close this hearing. I think what might work, just talking to the commission a little bit, is if we would consider a motion possibly to continue. And then when we bring this back up, there'll be no need for an additional public hearing. It'll already be there. So
moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Mr. Lee makes the motion. We have a second. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. This hearing is continued until further notice. Thank you. And the next hearing we have is a request by Lawrence Holdings to amend Indian Lake Village Phase 1A Final Development Plan. Property is located east of Indian Lake Boulevard and north of Saundersville Road, as shown on Sumner County Property Tax Map 145, Parcel 74. And we have nobody signed up for that hearing, and I will declare that hearing closed. Next on the agenda is request for information assistance. Hearing none, we move on to the minutes. We have the minutes of February the 7th, 2017. Do I have a motion? Mr. Millsap makes the motion. Do I have a second? Ms. Stringfellow? All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any abstentions? Okay, it's passed unanimously. We have a consent agenda item, George Whitten Elementary. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve.
Move to approve, call consent. We have a second. Second, Ms. Stringfellow. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Final plats. We move on to Savannah, Phase 7, Section 1. And they've agreed to all staff comments. Do we have any? Who's running this one? Is that you, Timothy, or Keith? Well, let's go ahead and go ahead.
All right, Chairman. This is the final plat for Savannah Phase 7. It was approved a few months ago. The developer is required to widen the shoulders, widen the street 1 to 2 feet, make ditch and drainage improvements, and construct sidewalks. The problem is that Chute Lane is not in the city. It's actually a county street. And the county road superintendent doesn't actually want the above improvements done to that roadway. So the staff and the developers have agreed for the developer to construct a bike trail along Chute Lane. This would start at a terminus of the trail that the developer will install in the common open space, if you remember from the original plan. It's located on the southwest corner of the subdivision. And then that'll connect with the sidewalk system within Savannah to create a walking trail. And this trail will extend eastward along Chute Lane to Cage's Bend, and then northward along the frontage of Phase 7. The developer has additional frontage on Cage's Bend. When that section is fully developed, they'll be required to continue the trail along that frontage. The city will pick up at that point and continue the trail across the large tracks of Cage's Bend and along the frontage of Phase 1 of Savannah. And that'll connect with the sidewalk system on Gaston Drive. And what we're looking to do is we're using previous payments which have been made for sidewalks along Cage's Bend frontage of Phase 1. And we would like for the Planning Commission to consider favorably to approve this agreement with the developer so that we can go ahead and, even though we're not able to make the improvements because it's on a county road, still getting some amenity and a walkway out there that would benefit the residents.
Okay. Do any of our commission members have any questions for Mr. Keith? Okay. Yeah.
Good evening. I guess my concern is I absolutely appreciate trails and those things are great for pedestrians and walking. But my concern is we've talked about as a body multiple times how dangerous that road is too, how curvy, hilly, narrow it is. And I thought that part of what this body was requiring initially when we discussed this issue was to actually make improvements to the roads. Once again, we're in the conundrum of dealing with adding more property but not fixing the roads. So essentially, it's kind of what these fine people have been talking about tonight. You know, we're back to that same scenario with Savannah. I think the bike trail is a very nice thing, but it doesn't improve the safety. It doesn't improve the drivability or the traffic or those issues on that road as we add more houses. I understand the politics piece of the county and the city and those things, but is there, I mean, surely there's something else we can do.
Marshall, would you like to address that?
Yeah, I can speak to that. For months, we had gone down the path to improve the road, and we thought that was going to work out, but further discussions with the county, we could not come to terms on reaching any kind of agreement to let us improve that road. We were, of course, you know, surprised by that, but you know, the county did not, you know, they were pretty adamant they did not want those improvements. So, it.
Mr. Lee.
Well, I'm just agree with my colleague. I'm just shocked living right off of Chute Lane. And it too is a dangerous road, and certainly we have heard before from Savannah residents about drainage issues, about road issues, I'm wondering. Did you actually have discussion with the road superintendent?
We did, several discussions.
Has anybody else in the county been? That we've raised this discussion with?
I'm not sure if Fred has. I can't speak to that, but there may be a possibility that there were other discussions had, but I wasn't involved in those discussions.
But the report for us tonight is that no agreement has been reached. Am I correct in that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Mr. Lee?
Well, I'm just going to say I'm going to oppose this change so that our staff will have the opportunity to go back and to negotiate with the road superintendent, perhaps even inform the county executive or whoever we need to involve with this. I hate to delay the project, but I agree that, you know, putting in a bike trail, as great as that is for bikers, is not going to do much for the thousands of people and cars that are going to be going up and down that road.
Mr. Millsaps.
I want to ask a question, and I don't want to put you in a professional bind, but I don't know any other way to ask this question. Did they happen in the process of saying no give you any indication in the conversations that you were a party to mm-hmm. What they were looking for to say yes?
They would like the city to take all of Chute Lane, the entirety of Chute Lane. And we, at the time, were not willing to do that.
Okay.
Question.
Okay. Call the question.
I'll call the question. All right. Unless there's someone else that wants to speak.
I don't think there is a motion on the there's
I
no motion yet.
Motion. I'm
sorry. I would say
no, I okay.
Yeah, well, I would say though that the question would be is to do we deny this or do we defer it until it can be worked out through staff? And Keith, you kind of brought us up to date. Tell us give us some guidance here on that.
I haven't been involved in this particular particular agreement. I think if the pleasure of the commission to defer it to maybe give another opportunity, we could certainly do that. There may be somebody from the developer that's in the audience today that would be able to speak to how that impacts whatever their situation is.
Okay. Do we have a representative from Savannah? Yeah, please.
Okay. Matt Reginald with Fisher Arnold, 256 Seaboard Lane. It's good to see everybody again tonight. You know, as kind of Marshall said, we've really been trying to work with the county and with the city to try to be able to get these improvements because we saw, you know, we wanted to be able to put this in, to be able to add that based on what you guys recommended. And after talking with the road superintendent, and trying to talk to others, it was just very apparent that unless the city took on all of Chute Lane, which part of Chute Lane y'all don't have constituents on either side of, so you wouldn't have any tax benefit, you'd have more tax burden, that that the county was not going to allow any of those improvements unless you took that fully in. So we did everything we could on our end, you know, talking to the superintendents, working with the city. And as we talked about it, we wanted to be able to do what we could, and that's why we came up with, you know, at least providing the trail at the, you know, at the minimum, so that we can at least give the accessibility that we talked about, making sure we have that walking trail that connects into the internal portions of Savannah as well, and doing what we could. So, and I know this project has been deferred several times. We've had several meetings, and they're really kind of at that point of wanting to begin. We have all of our other approvals. This is kind of that last little piece. I know someone brought up drainage. We were able to work with the county. We will be replacing the culvert that goes under Chute Lane, increasing that to improve the drainage coming through that area. So we'll be able to fully handle the fully developed flow. So they did. The county did agree to that portion, but they wouldn't agree to the additional roadway surface and shoulder that they'd have to maintain.
Okay. What's the will of the commission here?
All right. Am I recognized?
Yeah.
Okay. For me, I truly applaud the efforts of the developer in this scenario. We've been a long ways coming for Savannah, and it's been, I mean, this room's been packed several times with this issue. And so for this, I applaud you guys. This truly is not your issue. So I don't want to shoot you down, but I have to lean toward the side of safety. I am so tired of us not taking care of the infrastructure. And we've heard that time and time again from almost, it feels like every subdivision in the city regarding that issue. And this is the time when we really tried to do this right. and still have some opposition. I don't know, maybe I'm just a hopeless optimist. But, you know, I just feel like there's power in people, power in persuasion. And even though we live in the city, we live in the county too. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as far as Savannah residents or whoever else needs to be involved, I just feel like we haven't exhausted our resources yet. So based on my little soliloquy here, I move that we defer this issue, provided that a deferral is not an acceptance. In this scenario, I move that we defer this issue to give it just a little bit more time for us to see if we can come to some resolution so that we can truly have improvements on a road that really needs improvement.
Do you want to give a time frame until the next first of the month meeting?
That would be fine.
Okay. Is that acceptable? I second that motion. We have a motion to defer and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Oh, I want a discussion.
You want to discuss? Okay, go ahead.
I just had a question for Marshall. So it kind of seems like they're blackmailing us. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just the bottom line here. Do you feel like going back? Because I don't see that the developer has any fault here either.
No.
Do you feel like going back? Was Judy Harden the one that was involved in these negotiations?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so do you feel like deferring it and going back that we're gonna get any further with this?
I can speak with Chip Moore, the director, and see if he would be willing to take the road.
What if we just take this section? I mean, there's got to be some kind of compromise here.
It was all or none.
Well, that is not in the spirit of cooperation of the municipalities and the county.
And I think we do need to make sure that the county commissioners from that area be fully aware of what this situation is, and that the obstinance that the county is giving us to improvements to their road for the citizens that live in their district.
Okay. And for those reasons, we have a motion to defer and a second. Any more discussion? All in favor of the deferral, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Opposed.
One opposed. Okay, Ms. Ash. Thank you. We now come up to Stonecrest Phase 5, Section 2, final plat. Anybody here representing Stonecrest? And I believe Timothy is handling this one.
For Section 1, the applicants have agreed to all staff comments.
Okay. Stonecrest, Phase 5, Section 1, they've agreed to all staff comment. Move to approve. Got a second? Got a second. Ms. Stringfellow, any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, we move on to Stonecrest, Phase 5, Section 2. Timothy.
For both Section 2 and Section 3, I don't know if you want to group these together or not, but for both of these sections, the applicants have agreed to the staff comments, with the exception of Public Works comments 2, 3, and 4. Marshall, do you want to speak to that?
Marshall?
Timothy may have to jump in and help correct some of what I say, but kind of the gist of it is that there was an FDP approved in 2007.
Okay.
Since that point, the city has adopted a major thoroughfare plan that calls for improvements to Sarnesville Road. The final plats were approved at that same time for these phases. They have since expired. Now, fast forward 10 years, in making my comments, I made the comment that, for the plat that has frontage on Sarnesville Road, they would have to comply with the major thoroughfare plan. 10 years ago, they'd agreed to make a payment in lieu for curb and gutter and sidewalk along the frontage. And now, with compliance with the major thoroughfare plan, there is an additional lane of traffic on their side for Saunersville. And that's the, that's kind of the conundrum. Do they, with having an approved FDP, are they, considered vested? Do they have to comply you know, with the major thoroughfare plan as outlined in the subdivision regulations.
Okay, thank you, Marshall. We hear from the developer.
David Lucky, Southeastern Building. There's a little bit of history here. I just want to run back through it. Early 2000s, before we received the zoning for Stonecrest, we had a Mayor Fuqua was in office, and we had to actually contribute money to the widening, and then actually my company widened Saundersville Road. We did all the work out there 12, 14 years ago, early 2000s. We've contributed and contributed and contributed to the improvement of Saundersville Road over the years. In 2007, when we had the first part of this property was all approved in the early 2000s as well. In 2007, when we came back and we rejiggered it and we made part of it a PUD, we agreed to the improvements Marshall spoke of. It's fine. And we met all requirements required of us at that time. 2009, the city adopted a new long-range plan. And on page 5.5 of that transportation plan, it says Saundersville Road connector, lower station to Vietnam Veterans, is two-lane divided, has an asterisk next to it. It says to be initially constructed and improved as a two-lane divided right-of-way, sufficient for a four-lane divided section. Future improvements will improve the roadway from a two-lane divided cross-section to a four-lane divided cross-section. I built all of that. So we've even met this. We're not asking to change our plan. We're not asking to add any more units. We've already done everything. We're just up here getting our final plat approved of a five-section community. This is phase five. To come back and require us to do additional stuff now is frankly ludicrous. I mean, I've got subdivision sections all over the city. It'd be like me coming in here and somebody going, well, you've got nine sections over here at Winbrook. This is the ninth section. We want to redo a traffic study out here. I mean, we've made all these decisions. There's been other subdivisions that have been developed, a lot of changes that have happened, but I didn't increase any density. Mine's already there, and I've paid for mine. I'm just asking to go ahead and go forward my project the way it was originally presented and approved, and we've done everything that we committed to. That's it.
Okay. Anything by the commissioners? Any questions? The question, of course, comes, and let me just make sure I understand, that the FDPs did expire?
No. A final master development plan never expires. What he's talking about is
the plats.
The plats,
yes,
expired, but our zoning was already vested. It's been vested since back then.
So the plats expired.
That's correct.
Timothy?
David's correct. The FDP has not expired. It's still valid. That FDP, that the minutes where that was approved, it was stipulated that the developer would pay for sidewalk curb and gutter along Saundersville. The plats were approved the same year, were never recorded. The ordinance says that they expire after, I believe it's 3 years. As far as the zoning, the ordinance under which that FDP was approved, that development is vested in that old ordinance. There's no doubt about that. But what we're talking about are infrastructure improvements that arise not out of the zoning ordinance, but out of the zoning the subdivision regulations, same regs that were in effect then as now, and those subdivision regulations reference the major transportation plan. That's what changed.
They reference the major transportation.
Okay, Mr. Lucky, we've given you an opportunity to speak. Giving you an opportunity to speak, please let Mr. Witten. Thank you.
That did change. The major transportation plan was updated in 2009, and then the plats expired. So, you know, I've been through the subdivision regulations, land use plan, you can find no, there's no verbiage in there. It states that an FDP is somehow vested under the old transportation plan. It's clear that when the plats expire, that those plats are to be brought into compliance with the current major thoroughfare plan. Okay. I did get feedback from Fred from a Sunny Beach in Florida on that, agreed with that, and we also did discuss that with the city attorney this afternoon, and agreed with our position on that.
Okay, thank you. Any commissioners have any comments? Mr. Lucky, I'll give you one more shot.
I disagree with Timothy.
Okay.
And this, and it's ambiguous at best. I think the argument can be made in our favor as well. We weren't privy to the meeting that was held with the city attorney. We weren't involved in these discussions. But, and I sat in here when we approved the subdivision regs in 2004. I'm very well aware. And we complied and continue to comply. And I think the argument absolutely can be and will be made that we were subject to the transportation plan that was in effect then.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Lucky. The question before us then.
If I could say one more thing.
Okay.
Just wanted to clarify what David said about the, back in 2000 contribution for widening to Saundersville Road. I was not aware of that. That was before I was here. I'm not sure how that plays into it, if it does. Marshall, I don't know if you want to speak to that or not, but I just wanted to clarify that I was not aware of that.
Okay. Anything else about the contribution?
No, I don't have anything to add.
Okay. All right, commissioners, we have a situation where the plats have expired. There is a new plan that's been put in place for a particular potential upgrades, and so this is the issue we're facing. And it goes to the Public Works comments 2, 3, and 4, which they agree with all staff comments except those particular comments in 2, 3, and 4. And so what we need to decide tonight is do we go forward with the agreement here and allow Mr. Lucky to continue, disrespective of comments 2, 3, and 4, or do we basically say no, comments 2, 3, and 4 do apply. So I'll entertain discussion at this point. Mr. Lee.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, certainly I want to commend Mr. Lucky for the developments that he has had along Saundersville Road and for the improvements that he has made along that road. And certainly if we're in phase five, then it's been a very successful business investment and venture for him, as well as for the citizens that live there. But just as we can't go by old speed signs or speed zones and speeding laws change, then standards do change and improvements to standards change. And I think it's been our policy, we've been very consistent, that as those standards change, that we enforce the standards that are in place. So I would be very reluctant. I do feel for Mr. Lucky. He feels like he's done a lot for our city, and he has. Yet at the same time, I do think that every plan we approve should be to the standard that is current.
Yes, sir. Okay. Anybody else? Do we have a motion, or Ms.
I just
Ashley?
Had a quick question for Mr. Lucky. The traffic study, I understand that. What potential improvements do you see to Saundersville Road, considering everything you've already done?
Here's the problem with a traffic study. When do you date the traffic study? Y'all have approved Millstone with a traffic study that should have taken my development into account. If y'all approved that community with that traffic study, then all the improvements should be made. What I'm concerned about is what I don't know. I mean, do we date a traffic study back before Millstone Willowbrook was approved, or do we do it current? I don't know. I don't have any idea what could be required. So y'all have let me go out here and develop a two or 300 lot community. I'm in the last phase of it, and now all the rules are going to change, and you want me to go do a traffic study with a new community across the street that wasn't there when I developed this one, and you want to hold me to that requirement? Are you going to go over there in the next section they come in with and hold them to the same requirement too? You're not going to do it. You don't do that on any subdivision. You don't approve the subdivision, and then five sections later go, oh, well, we're going to change everything around again. I mean, guys, I wrote a big check. It was in between $300,000 and $500,000, plus I did the road work out there. It's not like I'm in here trying to get away with something. I've done and done and done. I'm just saying, let me finish my community.
Thank you.
Okay. Marshall?
I just wanted to clarify that my two comments, there was one regarding the infrastructure along Saundersville. The second was the traffic study regarding just if a left turn lane was needed into the new entrance that connects to Saundersville. That was the only, the only desire I had was to find out if it was warranted to add a left turn lane into the new entrance.
So a limited traffic study?
Yeah. Yes.
Limited to that entrance?
Yes.
I'd agree to that.
Okay. All right. Everybody okay?
I had a question.
Okay.
So my question is, and this is pretty much either Marshall, Timothy, or Mr. Lucky. I'm not sure who could answer. And I think it kind of piggybacks off what Ms. Ashley was asking. Number three says we've resolved to. So when we look at number three, complete all improvements to Saundersville Road as outlined in the city's transportation plan along property frontage. Mr. Lucky enumerated several things that he had done and read from the traffic plan, transportation plan, of what the improvements that he's made that were consistent with that plan. What's left?
The change, and I might misunderstand your question, but the change from when he did it, it's essentially double the size in the time that the plats have expired. The requirement now is for four lanes on Saundersville instead of two lanes. And so his frontage, for example, he'd have to have two 12-foot lanes of traffic instead of one. That makes.
I can answer that if you want me to.
Please.
Okay. When we built the road, we graded it out. It was designed for two lanes both way section, and so the grading's there. What I think you're asking is what improvements did I do then that are now? The difference is they, in 2009, they changed all the improvements and actually identified that it was supposed to be two lanes going both ways at some point in the future. We don't know if that's tomorrow or 10, 20 years from now. That's the difference. I did what was required to be done then. Does that help?
It does. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. But you would agree to a limited traffic study on the?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. All right. Any motions to be made?
I'll move to group and approve section two, final plat, section three.
Final plat, sorry. And with a limited traffic study addressing only the left turn lane into the development.
Okay. First of all, let's get a motion and a second to group. We'll do that real quick.
Okay.
Second. Okay. More discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. We've got a motion to group. Now we consider them as one. Ms. Ashley's motion to restate it. She's already made it kind of, but she wants to approve with staff comments 2, 3, and a limited traffic study on comment number 4. You make that motion, Ms. Ashley?
That's correct.
We have a second.
Second.
We have a second. Ms. Stringfellow, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed?
Opposed.
Two oppositions.
Can I ask a question? Just so I'm clear. Y'all about got me confused up here. It's easy.
We've approved the final plat with work comments 2 and 3 and a limited traffic study on comment number 4 with respect to the turning lane, I believe.
Okay. That's it. Limited traffic study.
I think that's what we agreed to.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Question.
We've got seven members present. One, two are opposed. Did the motion carry?
Motion carried.
All right. The next we have is a preliminary and final development plan. Indian Lake Center Phase 1, public with the added use of the kennel. They've agreed to all staff comments. Anybody handling this? Who's handling this one? Mr. Keith?
Suzanne.
Okay, Suzanne.
Just a quick note, the staff comment from the fire department needs to be removed. That was put in there by error. So this is an Indian Lake Center plan development, specifically the parcel that's just to the east of where Publix is. And the only thing that's permitted in these, I guess, is retail. And I think a while back you guys have approved a church to go in there. What the applicant is requesting is a kennel for like a doggy type daycare. And kennel is allowed in just straight zoning, GC, which this is GC in a plan development. And I believe the applicant is here if you want to hear from them.
Okay, if the applicant could come forward, we'd like to hear from you.
My name is Jason Rowell. I'm actually the broker that's representing my client here, Dana and Jody Good. And be happy to answer any questions or kind of go through the notes that I sent you guys last week, whatever you prefer.
Okay. Any questions? Have a motion?
Move to approve with all staff comments.
Okay, move with all staff comments, Ms. Key. And then seconded by Ms. Atchley.
Yep.
Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
The next question we have here is a amendment, final development plan amendment to Indian Lake Village Phase 1A. And this is located on Indian Lake and Saundersville Road. Do we have the applicant here?
Yes.
Okay. And who's handling this one? Timothy.
All right. So up on the screen is the current final master development plan for Indian Lake Village. The subject property is here. It's known, you can barely see it, but what's known is the power center. It's south of the streets of Indian Lake and north of the parcels along Saundersville, one of those is Hampton Inn. Over to the east of this parcel is the Watermark, or I think it's Bell Hendersonville Apartments, Lux Apartments up by the bypass. Then the New Citizens Bank is down there at the corner of Cinema Drive and Saundersville. The plan calls for big box or mid-sized box retail on the 15-acre parcel. That shopping center faces the kind of the back of the streets of Indian Lake. The owners have been, with both the past owner and the current owner, have been unable to find suitable tenants for such a retail shopping center. So that brings us to the current, the proposed amendment to the master plan. This shows an independent living facility on the east section, the east 5 acres of the parcel. They are proposing to add independent living facility as a permitted use for this area and for the location indicated. They're proposing up to 138 units and it could be up to 3 stories tall. Independent living is not the same as assisted living. And I'll just read you the definition of the ordinance. Independent living facility is a residential complex containing dwellings where the occupancy is limited to two persons who are 55 years of age or older or if two persons occupy a unit, at least one shall be 55 years or older. Such facilities may include common areas for meals and socializing, offer minimal convenience services, but exclude institutional care such as medical or nursing care. An independent living facility shall not include assisted living facility, community residence, or nursing home. So for the remaining area, the remaining about 10 acres of that property over to the west, they're showing a shopping center, perhaps a mid-sized box tenant, along with smaller tenants on the north and south sides. It's been rotated 90 degrees to face Indian Lake Boulevard, which the owner says is any prospective tenants would find that more appealing than facing the back of the streets. This is, as I said in the staff report, one of the last remaining major retail parcels. There are a lot of rooftops coming up out of the ground and are planned. Millstone, 620 units. Durham Farms, 1,090. We got a submittal today for Forest Park, which is the Jenkins Farm. I believe it has around 700 units. And of course, we can expect more. With additional rooftops comes more demand and need for retail, for commercial square footage. So that needs to be balanced against the owner's inability to find a suitable tenant for a power center, and the fact that he does have a user now that's ready to go with an independent living facility. As far as the approval process, the Planning Commission makes a recommendation to BOMA for either approval or denial. That then goes to General Committee and then to BOMA for one reading.
Okay. All right. Approval for the independent living.
For the use and for this amendment to the master plan.
Okay. All right. We'll hear from the developer.
I'm Alan Ramsey with Reagan Smith Associates, here tonight representing Avenida Partners, who is the applicant, and have Jim Walker with Avenida Partners that can talk. If you all want to explore more of who they are and their specific product, he'd be happy to do that. We've got some more information if needed. But a couple things I want to add in addition. I won't repeat what Timothy said. This is within Indian Lake Village. We have gone through as required, gotten approval from the Design Review Committee within Indian Lake Village, so we've gotten that approval. Another thing I think that's important, something we've also talked to the city about, is because we're adjacent to the streets at Indian Lake, is that we have been kind of really from day one in conversation with U.S. Properties Group, who is the company that bought that property last year. And we've been in discussion with them about planning this overall property. One thing, and I do have a letter from them tonight. I have several copies if you want it. But they are supportive of this use change. Another thing is they've indicated that kind of westerly two-thirds seems suitable for retail, whereas the part we're talking about for independent living, they really struggle with and have indicated that in their letter to us, that they see that being suitable for retail. Other than that, again, I want to be respectful of your all's time. We are here to answer any questions. We do have more information if you want about this specific product, but we agree with the comments and ask for your approval.
I seem to remember we had a discussion, I think Randy was here, I think you probably were here as well, about something similar to this. It was kind of turned a little bit and actually coming all the way down to Saundersville Road, if I remember right. There was no action taken. It was just kind of a situation where we came together and looked at the uses, and at that time assisted living was incredibly in the picture, and so now you've come back with the independent living and the power center facing the Indian Lake Road. I've got to ask the question, and I know I want to make sure, Mr. Witten, with this amendment, what would be the possibility of them continuing on with independent living all the way through? Is that a possibility?
my staff comments is to revise the use listing to read special personal and group care facilities limited to independent living facility and only in the location shown in phase 1A. So that would effectively freeze that use for that 5 acres on the east side.
Okay, so we're putting a stipulation in there that this right. is the only place where that would be appropriate.
And the applicants have agreed to
that's
that.
Correct, and we agree with that, yes.
You're okay with that?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? Mr. Lee?
No, not a question.
No questions? Okay. All right. Hearing no questions, I would entertain a motion to go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I did want to comment about the project. And, you know, I have a real concern that we will be limiting the city's future development if we don't stick with the plan and keep the option open for some big block development. We have already approved numerous assisted living and independent living facilities. Next to Union University is going to be a huge independent and smaller assistant, but primarily independent living facility. So we have approved numerous options in the senior living arena, but I'm concerned that we are not going to have any options for large retailers for the future. I do believe that you know, in the Rivergate area and other areas, some of those properties continue to decline somewhat. It's not as desirable as it was, I just think our future, our city's future, is going to be more as a nice suburban living, commercial, retail development, recreational community. We're never going to be a large manufacturing community. We don't have the property for that. If we do this, we're not even going to have the property for any large big box retailers. So I will have to oppose this.
And I just to speak for a few moments myself on this issue of any of the issues that have come before us, you know, I've been on this commission since Indian Lake Village began. I remember one of my first meetings in 2004 was about the proposals of Indian Lake Village, and I've watched that change over all of these years, and some to the good and some, in my view, not so good. But we have allowed it to morph, and we've allowed it to kind of evolve, and the shelf, as we call this, I remember the discussions on having a power center there with respect to big boxes. And then, of course, we built residential up and down Saundersville Road with respect to Ashcrest, and then the apartments, actually two sets of apartments there behind the movie theater. And then, of course, when Randy came and showed us the ideas that they had for including this into that area, With all respect, I mean, I have the same issues. I really do, because this was to be, you know, in the thinking of the planners and the developers, was to be the trophy of our city. It was to be a area of marketplace and walkable living and that kind of thing. And I think we've accomplished many of those goals with our parks, with our sidewalks, and there's not a day that goes by, and I go down that road every day. People are running down the sidewalks, and they're jogging, and they're in the parks. You know, even on sunny days, you see hammocks put between two trees, and people out there sleeping. So, you know, I think you're seeing some of that ambience there. And then we come to this particular submittal with independent living, and while from a structural standpoint, to add that we already have 327, if I remember right, But with both apartment complexes, we have 327 units, and I may be off on the numbers, one or two. We have 327 units back there with two developments, plus Ashcrest. And then we add this particular, it really does seem like that to me. However, to make the argument, well, there's nothing around there like that, that's a hard thing to do. So I'm a little bit perplexed about this one. I'm inclined to want to say we need to stick to our guns on this one in terms of what we designed for that area. However, in Ferity, that has been in play for the last 10 years or better. And to date, we have not really seen the big boxes come into play, and I'm just giving it a fair hearing here. So I have wrestled with it myself, and I'm just speaking as one commissioner. But would love to hear from any of the rest of you, and I appreciate Commissioner Lee's comments as well. Ms. Atchley.
Well, I have a little bit different take on this. And the comment that strikes me is significant in this decision is that a substantial amount of retail development has occurred on outlots and in smaller retail centers on Indian Lake Boulevard. And I think we've all seen that, little strip centers, four or five, walk-in clinics, smaller type restaurants, that type of thing. And I think that really diminishes the demand for these large big box type properties. In my mind, I make a differentiation between assisted living and independent living in that these people at 55 to 65 to 70, even more, they're going to be out moving. They're going to be eating. They're going to be walking to the retail locations. And they're not driving. So we had a whole room full of people here talking about traffic and the impact it's having on our city. And you put a, I'm pretty sure everybody in here has been to Walmart. I mean, it is not. They have a huge parking lot, but getting there and getting out is challenging.
It's very challenging.
So where if you can cut through and do some different things to the smaller retail sections, it just that's what's developed. When you talk about 10 years ago, all of these small little retail,
they weren't there.
And now they're there. I mean, they're everywhere. So I do think it diminishes their ability to market as a big box. I don't see it as a negative at all. And as far as Hendersonville, we've talked about redeveloping areas of the city. And if they wanted to go to some of these, just like where the old Walmart was, there are areas where these big box retails can go.
Right.
I mean, and it would be a tremendous asset for the city for them to go there, or even the other end of the city. It would drive them there, supply and demand. But I think this is a good looking plan. And there's still a ton of retail right across from this, and I just don't see it as a negative.
Thank you for that, Ms. Atchley. I would say with the configuration as it sits right now, this is why I was on the fence with it. It's because the way they've got it laid out, it does lay well for other residential type uses on Cinema Drive that are already there, and there is the option of having commercial construction, big box construction facing Indian Lake Road. So, but I'm just stating that it's been a conundrum for me personally as I'm looking at this.
So. One thing, if I may add, with regards to, the power center and that sort of idea, which was again a great idea many years ago, the devil's in the detail on it. When you talk about retail and visibility, that sort of thing. I think that's one thing that the owners have struggled with in any conversation with retailers is, the Streets of Indian Lake is a great project. It's had its struggles, and that's one thing that we've heard loudly is
right.
To try, what can we do to help with that? And again, we've been in conversation, and, one thing as it relates to the retail that we're showing here, If I had to guess, that may morph and change too for the better. That may integrate some of that Streets of Indian Lake property. We don't own that, so we really couldn't show how that works. But when we talk about a big power center, we're talking about 15 acres here, And when you really look at that conceptual plan that was approved many years ago, it had a great-looking power center. Didn't have a lot of parking.
No.
You know, and that, you know, while if you left it all retail, you might get some more retail, but it's the parking and it's the visibility. And so that's when we look at the 15 acres really doesn't, it's not enough land to get a big power center. And there are other properties, I think, in the city. But I completely respect the concern about protecting retail, that sort of thing. But that's one thing, as I've kind of studied this, is, you know, with retail changing, with, you know, internet that was not what we had 10, 15 years ago, it's just changing and morphing. And those big boxes, they're not expanding. It's not to say they won't in the future that changes, but that's one thing I just wanted to provide there for you guys.
Okay. Any more discussion?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, you know, just one other comment in terms of that I would make is in terms of jobs. The number of jobs and the quality of jobs that we would be providing for our citizens, an independent living facility is going to be few jobs and low-paying jobs. A power center is going to be many more jobs, many more higher-paying jobs, jobs in marketing, jobs in business, and other areas. So again, not that this is not, it doesn't look nice on a sheet, but there are other places, and we have approved many other independent living facilities, and I would urge us not to take this prime piece of property and to waste it away.
Okay, we need a motion. Move to recommend approval of the amendment to the final development plan. Okay, with all comments. All right, we have a motion to approve. We have a second. Second by Ms. Stringfellow. Any more discussion? All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Anybody abstaining? I didn't hear the. Let's. You voted aye. Okay. All right. You voted aye. Okay. I'm gonna call for the vote one more time. We seem to be hedging here. I don't know why, but we've got a motion and a second to approve and to recommend approval to BOMA with. The final amendment to the final development plan, master development plan. Okay? And so, no discussion. So, one more time. All in favor of recommending approval, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. It passes. So ordered.
Thank you.
We have no site plans, no sketch plats, no preliminary plats, no rezoning requests. We have a staff-approved project, James Reese subdivision, resub lots 1 and 2 final plat. And it's just for your information. Maple Row Boulevard lots 10 through 14 final plat. Plumley Street lots resub lots 1 and 2. And we also have one other under other, the Walton Park Street acceptance. Who's handling that one? Anybody got any of your information on that? Okay.
Sure. The Donna Drive. The townhomes along Donna Drive, well, we reached a point where we can accept the street that they, I guess, that they improved along their frontage. And it went through Public Works Committee this afternoon, and now we bring it before you to accept.
Okay. So. Motion to accept?
So moved.
So moved. Second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried. So ordered. Do we have a motion, Mr. Millsap?
Chairman, I move we adjourn.
So have a second.
Second.
Second, Ms. Key. We're adjourned. Thank you.